At the beginning of the 15th century, this vast pyramid was the largest monument in the world. It was the heart of the powerful Mesoamerican city-state of Cholula. But in the space of a day, in 1510, a force of Spanish conquistadors swept through, destroying temples and looting treasures. Thousands were slain in a matter of hours. The great regional force of Cholula was toppled, and to emphasize their dominance, the Spanish built a church on top of the ancient pyramid. Abrupt and radical change flows through the history of Mexico, a nation propelled by three main forces. The struggle for power, which has defined this country over millennia. Land and nature, which have been the source of life and the cause of conflict and death since the earliest times. And faith in Mesoamerican gods and Christian iconography, which has been ever present throughout its existence. These are the beats, rhythms, and currents of Mexico, and they run through my blood. As an artist born here, and with roots stretching back generations, I want to take you on a journey through these three great stories, which have shaped not just Mexican art, but Mexico itself. History, art has always been used as a tool by those in power.
But for me, Mexico differs in how this incredible relationship between art and power can be seen so clearly across the millennia.
In this program, I'm going to explore how the artists of this land didn't only project the power of ancient civilizations, they also became powerful authors of Mexico's history. And they continue to give Mexican identity, voice, and power. In 1910, on the centenary of independence from Spain, the foundation stone was laid on what was to be, at 200 feet, one of the largest ceremonial arches in the world. It was meant to express the unassailable power of the most durable dictatorship in Mexico's history. Porfirio Díaz had ruled here for over 30 years with an iron fist, the strongest government Mexico had experienced since independence. Yet less than a year after this stone was laid, a revolutionary war began that would leave the Díaz regime in ruins. And when this arch was completed years later, it was christened the Monument to the Revolution. In the 10-year revolutionary war, over a million people died, and the old colonial order was completely overturned. Mexican civil society was shattered and traditional power structures eviscerated. When the shooting stopped in 1920, a fragile, uncertain New Mexico emerged, a country that desperately needed a uniting force, a new national story. The power to achieve this lay with art. There was one kind of art that dominated in the projection of this message. Muralism. Murals were works of art making a public statement. They told stories in epic scale, containing vast sweeps of Mexico's history, from its ancient past to its revolutionary present, and they also projected its future. But the power of murals wasn't simply in what they depicted. It was in their permanence.
What I love about muralism is that it can't be extracted from the place where it was made. It can't be removed from the context of its origin. The space can change function depending on who's looking after it, but since 1922, this has remained the same. And that's so different to works on canvas that we see in museums in Europe.
Mexico's most famous muralists were known as Los Tres Grandes: David Alfaro Siqueiros, José Clemente Orozco, and Diego Rivera. Together, they made an indelible mark on Mexican history by explaining its power struggles to the people and providing a vision for everyone to share. Where the muralists painted was just as symbolically important as what they painted. Here in my hometown of Mexico City, at the Colegio de San Ildefonso, murals implanted a potent message in the keen minds of young people who walked these corridors every day. For 400 years, this building was a school.
I feel very connected to it because my father went to school here. So he would often bring us when we were children and tell us about what it was like to go to school in such a historical place surrounded by these murals. They would walk past them on the way to classes, and sometimes he said, you know, they would stop and look, and sometimes they would just walk past them just like you would any wall that you see every day. So I find it particularly interesting to think that these works of art were actually part of a center of learning and what effect, consciously or subconsciously, they had on the students that walked past them every day.
What my father and countless other pupils saw painted on these walls was a defining event of Mexico's past. When the Spanish colonizers arrived in the 16th century and conquered the indigenous people of Mexico, millions died, victims of violence and disease. Rich and complex civilizations, including the Aztecs, were decimated by a power intent on plunder and fired by religious zeal. The indigenous survivors of the conquest would be subservient in their own lands for the next 300 years. This mural was painted in 1926 by José Clemente Orozco, and it contains a story of a woman whose personal experience lies at the heart of Mexican identity. She's known as La Malinche, and Orozco painted her sat next to the leader of the Spanish conquistadors, Hernán Cortés. She was a slave gifted to Cortés by the Tlaxcalan people, who allied themselves with the Spanish against the Aztecs. La Malinche was his interpreter, and to this day is reviled by many for helping the conquerors defeat her indigenous brethren. But the relationship had another profound result. They had a son, and the mix of Spanish and indigenous blood created a new ethnicity, the mestizos. Professor Renato Melo is a leading expert on Orozco and has studied his work for 30 years.
This mural has always caught my attention because in so many others, the indigenous woman is folded down, she's bent down. And this one's more complicated than that, isn't it? Because she is submissive, passive, dominated, but equally, for 1926, it was quite radical to give an indigenous woman equal stature like this.
This is a monumental Indian figure appearing on a public building, and that was just unthinkable 20 years before.
I would say that there are no previous indigenous women representations that are as strong as this one.
In this mural, Cortes looks like he's been sculpted out of stone, and he's quite stoic and lifeless and cold. And she seems to be full of life. She's fleshy and warm.
Yes, because it is a system of contraries, of opposing categories. So you have the male and the female, but also life and death,
representing both the colonial condition and also the race that is about to mix with the white race, which is the mestizos.
The mestizos symbolize Mexico's hybrid culture, the mix of indigenous and European blood, common to millions of Mexicans to this day, including me. But Orozco's painting is also a reminder that the power struggle between the two ethnic traditions has not been forgotten. This is a monument to the mestizo. La Malinche and Hernán Cortés sit surrounded by artifacts of pre-Hispanic and Spanish cultures. To me, it's an unremarkable work of art in the corner of a Mexico City park. But what's interesting is that this isn't its original location. People there didn't want La Malinche near them and insisted she was removed. For many Mexicans, she remains an immoral traitor. But for one of Mexico's leading writers, La Malinche has been maligned for too long. Laura Esquivel's novel, La Malinche, portrays a woman who is not only a translator, but a key mediator between the indigenous people and the invaders.
¿Por qué vamos a lanzar toda la responsabilidad y la culpa de la conquista a una mujer que hizo un trabajo sensacional, una mujer brillante, una mujer valiente? Vamos a suponer que hubiera querido traicionar. Ella no hubiera podido hacer nada.
Si
no se hace la alianza de pueblos que estaban hasta aquí, de los aztecas, y que se unen a los españoles, eso es lo que realmente logra la conquista. No una mujer. Además tuvo que traducir y ella aprendió español en 3 meses y nada más triangulando, nada más escuchando, y dominó la lengua. Actualmente seguimos arrastrando los mexicanos problemas que surgieron en la conquista. Entonces, a nivel inconsciente, ella representa a la madre y Cortés el padre. Entonces, si tú consideras a tu madre como traidora y prostituta y a tu padre como asesino y ladrón, ¿tú quién eres?
The conflict within the Mexican sense of identity continues today. La Malinche might never be forgiven by everyone, even as ethnic difference is not only tolerated, but now celebrated. For 400 years before the revolution, however, Mexico's growing mixed-race population was depicted in divisive and demeaning ways. Artworks known as castor paintings reflected official government attempts in the 18th century to classify people in descending social order. These popular artworks, often in a set of 12, reinforced ideas of racial superiority and a Spanish obsession with purity of blood. They were the mestizo of Spanish and indigenous mix. Mulatos were of Spanish and African descent. And at the bottom were ahí te estás, meaning stay where you are. A person born with a mix of Spanish, African, and indigenous blood. But in post-revolutionary Mexico, everyone was Mexican and equal in the country's past and present. This message of inclusion and rebirth was proclaimed loud and clear in a vast mural covering the walls of the presidential palace, the heart of Mexican power. Thousands of years of history cover 275 square meters. Events and characters from ancient and modern Mexico appear in what is nothing less than a new and radical chronicle of Mexican history in its entirety. The artist was Diego Rivera, one of the giants of 20th century art. His Epic of the Mexican People is one of the greatest murals anywhere in the world.
The actual experience is quite overwhelming.
Yeah.
And it really encompasses you as you're walking through it.
Yeah.
Art historian Claudia Molina has researched Diego Rivera's murals extensively.
Diego Rivera was thinking about the eye of the spectator, because the normal eye doesn't go from right to left or right to left. It goes like a circle. Yeah. Because we are on stairs, and all muralism puts the spectator in an active role.
Rivera created his mural as a triptych representing Mexican history in three chapters. On the right, there's the Aztec world, reborn and proud, rather than crushed and defeated following the Spanish conquest. The middle wall is called From the Conquest to 1930 and draws in the subjugation of the indigenous people, the War of Independence, and the Revolution. The left-hand wall is called Mexico Today and Tomorrow and features class war, attacking the exploitative nature of capitalism and the church, and exalting the revolutionary message of Karl Marx. Rivera was a committed communist and staunchly anti-religion, and it was his deeply held political views that made him the perfect artist to express the official line in post-revolutionary Mexico. This mural reflected Rivera's personal beliefs, but it was commissioned by the people in power, the new left-wing government, determined to control the nation's story.
The government and all the elite was very much interested in use art as a tool of power. Rivera chose a quote from the Communist Manifesto: "We don't need to reshape our society, we need to create one." So it's very much in tune for the Mexican government at the time. The commission was meant to, of course, show the Mexican history, but of course it was meant to be like the beginning of a new national identity born from the revolution. What's most interesting is that if you interview people nowadays, they believe this mural is true, it's their history. So that's what's amazing, because actually Diego Rivera is not only an artist and a painter, of course, he's an intellectual that became the best tool of the Mexican government to imagine and construct this imaginary of Mexico and its history.
That is the power of Rivera's art. His vision of Mexico, romanticized and ideological, is now part of our official history. 80 years after its completion, the mural still carries the weight of authority. Whenever Mexico welcomes foreign leaders, the president greets them in front of this panorama. It's an origin myth and propaganda rolled into one.
The government did a very good job photographing all these murals, publishing in magazines, newspapers, and of course, eventually, textbooks. So that's why all of these became the official images, yes, of national history.
Not least because the population was illiterate.
Exactly.
So they needed images.
Exactly. Like 80% of Mexicans were illiterate by the time, yeah, by 1921. So he knew images were the tool to accomplish all these projects.
The grand plan of using art to educate was the brainchild of José Vasconcelos. He was the Minister of Education, who believed that the revolution had given power back to the people. Giving the people knowledge would help reform the country and secure revolutionary ideals. And as well as understanding the revolution's place in Mexico's great story, he also wanted Mexicans to understand each other. At the Ministry of Education, Vasconcelos commissioned Rivera to show the new social and political realities of post-revolutionary Mexico. Working 18 hours a day for more than 4 years, Rivera and his team of assistants created an extraordinary tableau called The Very Life of the People, over 235 fresco panels. Rivera painted working people tilling their crops, breaking bread together, and if called upon, preparing for armed struggle. Rivera included his like-minded friends, his soon-to-be wife, Frida Kahlo, and fellow muralist, David Siqueiros. Those who didn't understand that power was now in the hands of farmers and factory workers were also depicted drunk and decadent. Having worked in Europe and the United States during the 1920s, at the turn of the 30s, Diego Rivera was a superstar with a global reputation. And despite being an ardent communist, he became hugely popular among the rich industrialists of the United States, where he and Frida Kahlo had quickly become the darlings of the cultural elite. In the US, Rivera's power was in his commercial value. A mural for the Stock Exchange Luncheon Club in San Francisco was followed by an even more remarkable commission, one that ended with a very personal power struggle. In exchange for $21,000, Rivera was asked to create a mural about mankind looking to a better future. His patron was Nelson Rockefeller, who wanted the Rivera fresco to adorn the Rockefeller Center in New York. The scion of one of the United States' richest and most powerful families approved Rivera's sketches, which showed workers, soldiers, and farmers united in optimism about future technology and its benefit for humanity. But Rivera was taunted by leftist groups who accused him of putting his principles aside for money. And so he changed the design and included a portrait of Vladimir Lenin. Rockefeller was furious, and when Rivera refused to change it, he ordered the fresco to be chiseled off the wall. But Rivera wasn't prepared to surrender his art.
So he decided to come back to Mexico and recreate the same mural here. And I'm so happy he did, because it's absolutely stunning.
Man, controller of the universe, is an almost identical version of the Rockefeller mural. On either side of the central figure are the dominating political ideologies of the time. Above capitalism, Rivera painted what he believed was its greatest failure: the First World War and the brutalities of machine guns and poison gas. On the right, Lenin supports the working class in their revolutionary struggle for power and justice.
Every single inch of it is covered with the politics of the time. It's so rich in symbolism.
At the center of the mural, a worker is mastering technology, sitting at the controls of the mechanical and natural worlds. Depending on his decisions, the world could be a socialist utopia, or it could be dominated by the debauched, rich bourgeoisie drinking martinis while millions perish. For the Rockefellers, it was a personal and political attack. For Rivera, it was a belated demonstration of his own power.
I think he had a crisis of conscience of being commissioned by one of the a family that was the epitome of the capitalist system that he was so against. They wanted his art, but they didn't want his politics.
While Rivera was obsessed with the idealistic visions of a communist future, other muralists were beginning to reflect the realities of a fast-changing and threatening world, where power was emphatically not in the hands of ordinary people. The Hospicio Cabañas in Guadalajara is one of the most incredible interiors in world art. It's been called the Sistine Chapel of the Americas. Here, José Clemente Orozco painted a story of Mexico that showed he was deeply worried about the future. As the 1930s went on, fascism spread in Europe, and Stalin's brand of communism saw millions exiled or executed. Orozco feared that reactionary forces could threaten Mexico's revolution and turn back the clock. I think the energy and drama in his brushstrokes make his provocative message an urgent one.
All these murals are working towards Orozco's climactic vision, what many consider his masterpiece.
In the dome of this chapel is Orozco's Man of Fire. This figure, engulfed in vibrant red and yellow flames, is an allegory of the destruction that technology and progress can bring. Man is trying to defy external forces as he ascends through fire. He wants to fly, but like Icarus of Greek myth, he will fall. Orozco completed the work in 1939 as right-wing nationalists declared victory in the Spanish Civil War.
This is a statement about individual freedom. And that was pretty much at stake at the time. Many people thought, Orozco amongst them, that what had happened in Spain, a reactionary uprising, a total destruction of the civil institution, that could happen in Mexico as well. Orozco realizes that some trends in anarchism, socialism, fascism, but also in the democratic discourse, are very dangerous.
Muralism had begun by serving power and transmitting the values of the revolutionary state. Now, it was confronting power, warning of the looming threats to the ideals of the revolution. And the ultimate expression of this fell to the youngest and most uncompromisingly radical of the big three, David Alfaro Siqueiros. For Siqueiros, art and revolution were inseparable. At 18, he quit art college to fight on the front lines of the Mexican Revolution. And in 1936, he fought in the Spanish Civil War, witnessing the triumph of the Nazi-backed fascists. When he returned to Mexico, he painted perhaps the most caustic warning against not just fascism, but the acquiescence of democracy and capitalism in its rise.
Wow.
Dominating a stairwell in the headquarters of the Electrical Workers Union in Mexico City is the portrait of the bourgeoisie. The mural is a triptych whose imagery makes no attempt to hide the anger and resentment of a man who had witnessed at first hand fascism defeat socialism in Spain.
It really envelops you in a very claustrophobic sense. You almost have to take a few steps back.
The mural is a warning to the Mexican proletariat of the implacable array of forces that confront it. For Siqueiros, the Mexican Revolution had stalled, co-opted by the bourgeois middle class. He shows the ordinary man crushed by stronger powers. A monstrous machine turns workers' blood into gold. Figures in gas masks represent Britain, France, and the US on the left, and Germany, Italy, and Japan on the right. Siqueiros seems to make them equally culpable for the money machine's grim business model.
Because he was really a revolutionary, and the themes that he's actually painting about were global themes of America and Europe, in his words, colluding with fascism and the ideals that he stood for falling. I think this sadness or disappointment came across as anger. And he took every opportunity to express that. And I think this is a great example of it. The values of liberté, égalité, and fraternité are burning. There's nothing ambiguous about that.
The only message of hope is a revolutionary figure bravely confronting the terrifying scene. But he's alone, symbolizing the isolation of the Mexican proletariat. Don't look to others to help, Siqueiros is saying to the workers. You are the only reliable weapons in the revolutionary struggle. And he carried this message of solidarity into the technique of the painting, working with a team of artists, using spray cans to remove the hand of the individual. What remains might bear only Siqueiros' name, but it's a call for unity and collective will.
It's amazing to me that it has remained so intact. It's absolutely flawless. And also thematically, it could have been made yesterday.
Ever the activist, Siqueiros didn't attend the opening of the mural in 1940. He was in hiding, accused of an assassination attempt on Soviet dissident Leon Trotsky in Mexico City. By the 1950s, the fervent ideals of the revolution had dissipated. Mexico's leaders wanted to position the country as a modern, liberal democracy. This colossal monolith represented what the powerhouse behind this modernization was to be. Library of Mexico's National University. The building opened in 1952, part of a huge investment in a new campus. The idea was that through universal higher education, the latent power of Mexico's population could be unleashed and a prosperous future secured. The library was designed by Juan O'Gorman, born in Mexico to an Irish father. Its monumental modernist form, mirrored across the campus architecture, expressed a technological sophistication that would be key to Mexico's development. But the true symbolic power of the library is not in the ways it points to the future, but in the ways it draws from the past. The building is windowless, covered in mosaic with murals rich in Mesoamerican imagery and mythology.
It feels like a glorification of learning and history. Like the Spanish Gauleses, the books that chronicled pre-Hispanic life and culture have been projected on every side of this building's massive facades.
Surrounding the structures are open plazas designed for everyone to congregate and socialize, regardless of whether they are students or not.
Un raspado de tamarindo con limón natural, por favor.
Sencillo, ¿verdad?
Sí, por favor.
I'm buying raspado, which is basically ice grated off a big ice block, and then you get all sorts of syrups that you can put on it. Limón exprimido, por favor. So I'm having a tamarind and lemon water, avoiding the chili. What's this? No, por ahora no, gracias. Mm. Good. Refreshing.
But to truly understand the thinking behind this spectacular space and its monumental architecture, you need to go back in time. This entire campus has been deliberately designed to project the power of education by mimicking the city planning of the most powerful pre-Hispanic civilizations. The pyramids and temples of Teotihuacan, more than 2,000 years old, were designed to inspire awe and wonder among the people, emphasizing the power of the elites and their evident connection to the gods. But it's the great city of Cholula that really underlines how ancient architects and artists were able to project power in spectacular fashion. What looks like a hill is in fact an enormous pyramid that covers an area of more than 45 acres, making it by mass not only the largest pyramid in the world, but also the largest monument ever constructed anywhere by any civilization. Gabriela Ruñuela is professor of anthropology and an expert on the great Mesoamerican site of Cholula.
The designs that they were using was made to communicate something to the population, to the viewer. But it was a tool for the government to express ideas. It is art, but it had a function beyond being just ornamental.
And what does it say about the civilization that built it?
You cannot build a monument this big if you do not have hierarchical society, no, which designs the monument to manifest its power in the building of something
exactly
this big.
Over millennia, successive pre-Hispanic civilizations made the Great Pyramid of Cholula even larger and ever more imposing. As the pyramid grew, so did the influence of the city and its elites. Cholula became the dominant regional powerhouse. For 500 years, rulers of other city-states came here on pilgrimage. It's said that even Aztec princes were anointed by Cholula's priests. Its dominance as a center of power made it a clear target for the invading Spanish in the 16th century. The rapid conquest of Cholula installed the Europeans as the new holders of power. For 300 years, they dominated, suppressing indigenous culture. But following the revolution that began in 1910, the power and significance of Mexico's pre-Hispanic culture was increasingly recognized. The Anthropology Museum in Mexico City's Chapultepec Park houses the world's largest collection of ancient Mexican art. Before I became an artist, I studied social anthropology, and I've always found this place inspirational. was more than a museum. It was created with an explicit political purpose: to draw together the different strands of Mexican identity and apportion them with equal power. Anthropologist Sandra Rosenthal has studied how the government used pre-Hispanic artistic heritage for social and political purposes over the decades.
Both the president of Mexico at the time, López Mateos, and the architect of the museum wanted to create a building that people would just stumble upon when they were going to the park, when they were participating in other tourist activities around Mexico City. And so Chapultepec was really the right place for this new museum. So the idea in the 1960s was to create a space that would allow for a collection that would show all of Mexico, represent all of this diversity that created contemporary Mexico.
So it's a real hybrid. There's a great modernist influence, but there's also pre-Hispanic influence.
The museum was very carefully planned and designed to portray two parallel images of Mexico. On the one hand, Mexico as a modern state-of-the-art country, and at the same time, the idea was that the museum would portray Mexico's authenticity, the exotic nature of its very own indigenous civilization. The architect Pedro Ramirez Vázquez really wanted that contrast, you know, this very sleek modernist style combined with something very authentic, very Mexican. It's very much a centralizing project. The idea was that the courtyard would sort of bring together all of this diversity into a unity that was structured around this center. This is very much a ritual space. I mean, we think about it as a museum, but it's also a ritual space where I think all Mexicans come at some point in their life on a sort of pilgrimage to see and experience what being Mexican entails.
One of Mexico's greatest artists had a profound understanding of the power of indigenous culture in Mexican nationalism. Frida Kahlo embodied post-revolutionary Mexico. Her father was of German descent and her mother a mestiza. She wore indigenous Tehuana dresses from the Zapotec region, inspired by the ideal of freedom and strength that the wearers of the dresses represented. And she revered Aztec traditions. My Nurse and I is a reinterpretation of the Catholic Pieta. But instead of the Madonna and Child, she portrayed herself as a baby being breastfed by an indigenous nurse whose face is covered by a pre-Hispanic mask. She's nurtured by Mexican earth, her origins rooted in Mexico's soil. Another painting, The Love Embrace of the Universe, shows an earth goddess enveloping her and her husband, Diego Rivera. Asleep on the left is her hairless pet dog, of a breed venerated by the Aztecs. Frida's heart is bleeding, symbolizing the ritual sacrifices of the Aztecs and Catholic iconography. Casa Azul is where Frida was born, grew up, and died. It's an intimate space that I'm often drawn back to.
I remember coming here as a child and being fascinated by this person, this personality, this figure. She was almost mythological, and then you came here and you actually saw her brushes and her wheelchair.
At the age of 18, a terrible accident left her to deal with chronic pain for the rest of her life, and later led to several miscarriages.
I remember being very moved and quite saddened when I saw this easel made for her to fit her wheelchair so that she could really go up to it. And I remember seeing her plaster casts, this tiny waist, and it was usually covered in painting. She spent most of her adult life in casts and having constant operations. This place doesn't feel like a monument, it doesn't feel like a museum. It feels so full of her, full of her art, full of her life. It feels like everything is as it was. And that makes it a very moving experience, actually.
What gave Frida's work its ultimate power was the depth of her convictions. She made the personal political, expressing a deeply felt connection to Mexico through her own struggles. I think her art is as emotionally charged today as it was when she created it, a time when she was just as important as the muralists in promoting a nationalism rooted in ancient history. Hilda Trujillo is the director of the Frida Kahlo Museum.
Hasta el siglo XIX, las élites políticas y económicas querían ser europeas, ¿no? Despreciaban todo lo mexicano, todo lo nacional. Y la revolución vino a cambiar toda una concepción política y cultural. Y tanto para la política como para el arte, el Estado moderno se basaba en regresar a los orígenes prehispánicos y populares, era la construcción de una identidad. Y esta casa tiene la atmósfera de esa época. Muchos artistas vinieron aquí después de la revolución a ver qué estaba pasando con ese movimiento artístico llamado muralismo que estaba surgiendo con poderosa fuerza.
In lending her voice to Mexico's struggle for an independent cultural identity, Frida expressed her commitment to the country and its people. But she never followed consensus.
Era una mujer muy inquieta intelectualmente y no respetaba cánones sociales. No le interesaba lo que la gente pudiera decir de ella. Yo creo que esa forma de ser tan original, tan libre, tan sin ataduras sociales, es un símbolo para las mujeres hoy. Aquí vienen gente de varios países, pero sobre todo vienen mujeres jóvenes que se identifican con ella. Frida es una bandera y así ella hubiera estado feliz de ser una bandera de libertad, una bandera de mujeres que luchan.
This is a power struggle that's as relevant today as it was when Frida was producing her work. But while that fight continues, arguably greater strides have been made to ensure the indigenous voice that Frida championed is heard. Nowhere is that voice more obvious than in the state of Oaxaca, in the south of Mexico. Many of its inhabitants are descended from the Zapotec civilization. It dates back at least 2,500 years.
Buenos días, señora.
The market here in Tlacolula is one of the oldest in Mexico.
So these are made from carrizo, which is a type of cane. And these baskets are to do your fruit shopping with, but they're also part of a really important ceremony in Oaxaca, which is where they share sweets and fruit. So the woman who's in charge of it that year, every year it's someone else, puts it on their head and shares fruits and sweets. So you'd put this on top of your head. Les voy a enseñar cómo sería. So you'd put it on your head like that.
Oaxaca has the largest indigenous population among Mexico's 31 states.
¿Quién come tanto pan?
Bastante.
The power of the indigenous communities, their political representation, and right to self-determination is now guaranteed by the Mexican state. Remarkable when you think that there are 69 different indigenous languages and myriad cultures recognized within Mexico.
What I love about these patterns is that they're inspired by the pyramids of Mitla. So you'll find that the most authentic ones are these geometric shapes, these diamonds, and these kind of tracings. So it's pure wool, it hasn't been mixed with anything. ¿Y de dónde sacan la lana?
De los borregos.
Yeah, I just said, where do you get the wool from? And she said, from the sheep. Gracias.
I'm wearing an embroidered tehuana top, typical of this area, called a huipil. And I styled my hair, according to tradition, for a special meeting I'm really looking forward to. The state of Oaxaca is home to Mexico's greatest living artist, Francisco Toledo. His outstanding career spans 5 decades. Toledo's inspiration comes in part from Zapotec mythology, and his art contains themes of identity, celebrating the culture of his people and the connection to ancient ancestors. Oaxaca itself and his roots here are very important to him.
Oaxaca is a lugar muy especial. Hay restos de las culturas prehispánicas, hay la colonia, hay la pintura de la colonia, la arquitectura, había un pequeño museo arqueológico. Pues todo eso seguramente que influyó en mi formación, ¿no? Bueno, yo iba a la escuela en la mañana y en la tarde me inscribí en la Escuela de Bellas Artes, entonces ahí empecé a saber de la pintura por la biblioteca que tenían. Entonces empecé a hojear libros de fotografía, de arte, pintura mural, Picasso, Miró, Tamayo, William Blake. Entonces muy temprano conocí la, bueno, a través de los libros.
But Toledo is an activist as well as an artist. For 30 years, he's used his art to finance campaigns for social justice, challenging those in power. While his own work is not overtly political, he acknowledges the relationship between art and power.
Pues es utilizado por la política, siempre ha sido utilizado, bueno, desde la religión, la iglesia, los grandes artistas del Renacimiento, bueno, todos, muchos trabajaron para el poder de las grandes familias, de los papas, pues hay toda una relación de mucho tiempo, ¿no? Y en México, bueno, como usted sabe, los muralistas también estuvieron cerca del poder. Sí, y el muralismo nace por esa cercanía al poder.
Proximity to power helped the muralists convey the message of what it meant to be Mexican after the revolution. And today, proximity to an external power means there's nowhere more crucial to protect this Mexican identity than when you're at its borders. Tijuana, right against the border with the United States, is one of Mexico's most vibrant artistic hubs. Art produced by a variety of individuals and collectives is inspired by the experience of ordinary people and by everyday politics. Their artistic statements are commonly known as border art. Ana Teresa Fernández's Erasing the Border is a defiant act of protest against the boundaries separating Mexico from the United States. Her brush eliminates the border, perhaps asking questions about the boundaries of national identity. I think this gets to the heart of how many Mexicans feel about a border created in 1848, which saw Mexican territory, including California, New Mexico and Texas, become part of the United States. And it also speaks to the issue of migration. Tijuana is the world's busiest land border crossing, with 50 million making the journey each year. They include commuters living in Tijuana, crossing daily to work in San Diego. Others are undocumented migrants in search of a new life. An unfortunate few, the victims of human trafficking. hazardous journeys and real discoveries by the authorities have inspired the work of Julio César Morales, Undocumented Interventions. I've come to meet an artist who's an integral part of Tijuana's creative community, Marcos Ramírez, known as R. He feels strongly that artists have a responsibility to respond to power and injustice, particularly now, following President Trump's controversial statements about Mexicans and the border.
Me and the people that think like me and are worried about the situation right now, they need to like open their hearts and they open their minds and open their mouth and say the things that need to be said. Otherwise, we're going to lose things that we it took us 150 years to gain. Respect to our rights and equality. No race is better than the other. Stuff like that that we thought that we had it already understood, you know, like that we had a control. And now it's going in the wrong direction.
So as a border artist, how do you relate to this binational existence? How does it affect your work?
Well, no, it affects it and provokes it, you know? Like, I don't know other way of being. So it's very hard for me to explain it, you know? Like, I've been here forever. I do not assume myself just as a border artist, but I'm not gonna start denying something that is evident I am.
The current political situation has propelled R. to return to an idea about Mexico's northern neighbor.
Trying to age this piece of fence so it's not that obvious that it's resembling the American flag.
Stripes and Fence Forever, this the original work, is a comment about the lure of the United States losing its luster, that crossing the border doesn't mean dreams come true.
This flag represents the 50 states and the 30 old colonies. And then it's supposed to be a melting pot. Mm-hmm. Seems to me that the pot is melting.
Yeah,
is what
definitely.
It looks like to me.
Power and the proximity to power fires the creativity of artists working in Tijuana. In the 21st century, power and art are as inseparable as ever. Across the millennia, struggles for power have forged this country. An artist have been at the epicenter of each one. From projections of authority that held ancient civilizations together to creating a new national story and reinforcing Mexican identity, artists have themselves been the power brokers in Mexico's story. In the next episode, I explore how faith across the millennia has been dominated by art that underpinned and changed the very nature of belief.